today with your people, singing praises, rejoicing in the day that you've given us, the day that you have made. But God, I don't want to leave here this morning just happy because I've been around people, with my stomach filled with delicious food, and not be changed by you and your Holy Spirit this morning. So we ask, Lord, that you would continue the work that you're doing of shaping us, of crafting us as a community that follows you faithfully. We pray that you would do the work that you want to do this morning, that we would have ears to hear for this day. In Jesus' name, amen. How many of you consider yourselves good test takers? Yeah. Yeah, like morning of, you're ready to go. I know for me, like, there are some tests I feel good because I prepared for it, and then other tests I'm just like, I don't feel prepared, and that's okay. If in doubt, put C, let's go. I love taking tests. Way more than a paper, any day. But how many of you know that we also have other tests that come in our lives that aren't just paper or computer? And I wonder if we're as ready and as excited for those tests that we took. Those trials. Those temptations. They might be a temptation that hits us just like that out of the blue, or it might be something that you see coming, a test, a challenge, a sickness. I think about what Amy's going through. I think about what Vernon Doyle's going through, who follows us online. A trial, a test. And we all have these things. I've been thinking about so many of you throughout the week and the trials that you are going through now, that you have gone through this year, in the past year. We all face it. And we're not alone. We've seen in Scripture from the very beginning, people have been facing tests and trials and temptations, and some responding well, some not. Our legacy as people is Adam and Eve responding really poorly, sending us off in a horrible trajectory. But then we have giants of the faith, like Moses, who didn't respond well. He responded in anger. It hits the rock. We have David. David sleeping with another man's wife and then having that man killed. We have some people in our heritage. You think about Peter. Peter is like this giant. Does some things in Jesus is around the knucklehead, but then even years later, we see him saying, oh, yeah, Gentiles are included in the people of God until the people who he started feeling some pressure by, he was like, nah, I'm actually just going to go hang out with the Jewish people. We see him not responding to the test well. We're far too familiar of so many Christian leaders as well. The list is, I feel like, every week, more people get added on to it, and it's a weight that we carry. So we're not alone. We all face tests. Some large, some small, but all of them revealing our character and shaping our character. Because what I love about following Jesus is that the devil wants to throw these tests, these temptations, our way to bring us down.
But God
wants to use them to build us up. Exactly.
Yeah.
I've been going down through that for 2 weeks straight.
Longer than 2 weeks.
Longer
than. Character being formed by what you're going through.
I got warriors that I can talk to and they're letting me know.
The devil wants to send things our way to cut us down. But God wants to use those things to chisel us, not to break us, but to chisel us into the image that he's creating us to be. But we need to respond well. We need to be prepared for the test that we're going to face. There's a Hebrew rabbi that said this. He said, "My child, if you come to serve the Lord, prepare yourself for testing. Prepare yourself for testing." So I want to ask the question this morning, how can we be prepared for the test that we're going to face? And I'm going to present with, we are prepared with humility, community, honesty, and by the power of Jesus Christ. The next verse in the Lord's Prayer that we've been going through is Matthew 6, 13, and it says this. It says, "And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil." Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. We've been looking at this prayer. We've seen that it starts with acknowledging who is who we pray to, our Father. And then talking about his name being honored as holy, his kingdom come, his will being done, placing our prayers within the person and the purposes of God. We're not praying for our will, but for God's will. And then we started talking about our daily needs. God, give us our day, this day, our daily bread. Last week we talked about forgiveness. And now we're looking at temptation, test, and trial. And from the very beginning, it might strike us as odd. Lead us not into temptation. Is God a sort of God who's going to lead us into temptation? James makes it very clear. He says, no one undergoing a trial should say, "I'm being tempted by God." Some of us need to hear that today. When you're in the middle of a temptation, you're like, "I don't know how I got here." I think you can think of how you got there. It's probably not just God making you all the decisions, right? This word, though, isn't just used for temptation. It's also used for a test or a trial. Because it's interesting that the Spirit led Jesus into the wilderness where he was tempted. Now there's a lot going on there. Jesus is taking on the purpose of the nation of Israel, who was also led into a wilderness, but did not respond faithfully. But Jesus responds faithfully when faced with the temptation of, from the enemy. Praise God. So we think about this word not just as temptation, but including that, but test, the trial that we face. And it could be different. Again, it could be pain. It could be the temptation you and I are going to face later. Yes. Crystal Gonzalez says this, "These temptations arise every time we face a decision, which strikes me as really daunting, unless I remember that we have a God who's with us all the time. Not just when we're with a big time, but all the time. He's given us his Spirit. And these tests are not just opportunities for us to fail, but they're opportunities for us to grow. I brought something with me. Some of you may need it this morning. Do you know what this is? It's Cheaper. Are you sure it's Cheaper?
Not cake.
Could be. Why do you think it's Cheaper?
The label?
The label says it's Cheaper. There's really...
What is that?
It looks like Cheaper. But there's really only one way to find out if it's stupid. We have to exert some pressure and see. You know, like some people do it from the bottom. Remember, like we might think, "Isaac, you gotta start doing it from the bottom. You're gonna be married someday, and your wife is gonna hate it if you don't do it." Someone who doesn't hate it. In our house, we just go. Yeah, that's not for you. But some of you are going through the pressure. You're feeling it, right? You're going to step in this later today. Adrian told me you should put some cardboard down. I said, "No, we can walk in it. We'll remember when we go away." He's kind, and I'm sort of sometimes rude. But some of you are feeling that. You're feeling the pressure, and it's revealing what's inside of you. Because you might have the label of, oh, I'm a Christian, yeah, I follow Jesus, but when you're experiencing the pressure, what's coming out of you? But the test doesn't just reveal what's inside of you, it's also shaping you for the future. It's not just showing where you're at in the present, it's preparing you for your future. I know some of us, we're in the middle of a lot of responsibility. At work, at home, and it's tempting just to take an easier option. God, maybe I'll do the bare minimum. Okay, I'll be present, but I'm not going to do everything that's required. I don't need to. But I would encourage you to exert the energy to prove and shape the character of patience in that situation. Maybe you're experiencing this as a pressure of sexual desire that's looking for ungodly outcomes. And I'd encourage you to let that pressure prove and shape a character of holiness. You might find yourself in a financial situation where you're feeling squeezed. It's like, man, I don't know how we're going to cover all of this. But let that pressure prove and shape a character of generosity. By the way, I'm an Enneagram 2. I found out. You are too? Good job. That's amazing. And if I remember correctly, I didn't pay a whole lot of attention, but one of the things that said is we struggle to let people know our needs. We just sort of like do our thing and expect. So here's what I need from you this morning. All right? I'm going to need some like feedback. I need more Millie. I need you guys to come with me this morning. Yeah. So,
all right, we're with you. We're
I'll here. Hear you talking with the food. I want to hear it now. All right, so how can we be prepared for the test that we will face? First, we need humility. This passage, Lord, lead us not into temptation. It's posturing us as if people say, you know what? I don't want to be tested. Not because I don't want to be shaped and formed by you, God, but because I realize the risks. And I'm not sitting here as some over-eager test taker like, yeah, I got this. No, Lord, I don't know. I'm sort of nervous. And it places you in a humble posture saying, Lord, I'm going to move forward. I ask not for the temptation, but I know that if you're going to lead, if you're going to take me there, then you're going to stay with me and see me through. We think about Jesus in the garden. We need humility. Secondly, we need to do this in community. All throughout the passage, we see words like us, words like we. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Can I encourage you? Let someone know the test that you're facing. Bring someone in to the struggle that you face. Because you can't do it alone, and I can't do it alone. Who's that person in your life that says, look, hey, this week is tough. I need you to pray for me. I need you to check up on me. It's like, I just give up. I don't take a break. But that's us looking out for one another. Don't let the little guy be guarding the foe. Don't place him in that position just to get dumped on and destroyed. We do this as a community. So we prepare with humility, we prepare with community, we prepare with honesty. So lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. This but here is a strong contrast. You know, sometimes we say just like a soft contrast. What? Sometimes you're like, hey, I'd love to have you over, but today's just not a good day. You know, like, you genuinely probably want them to come over, but it's just not working out. It's not a like, hey, I'd love to have you over, but I just don't like you. Or, you know, when it's like, I love this person, and I would never say anything bad about them, and you know what's coming. That strong butt is coming, right? Yeah, that butt's been worked out for a while. And it's like, I don't want to say anything about them, but it's like, oh, And that's sort of the strength that's coming in this passage. Lead us not into temptation, Lord, but deliver us from evil. There's an honesty here saying, Lord, we need your help to be delivered from evil. Because we face a serious foe. I think sometimes the caricatures of Satan, you know, like the little red guy, the pitchfork, that has served to help the cause of evil far more than ours. Because that which we mock, we don't take seriously. That which we mock, we're not prepared for. It's not like, oh man, tomorrow that little guy with the horns and the pitchfork might be coming after you. Like, okay. That just makes me like a lazy, overeager test taker. N.T. Wright talks about three responses to the problem of evil. And one is sort of this head in the sand, I don't want to think about it, I just want to be happy today, don't talk to me about problems going on. The other is just wallowing in it, like, oh my goodness, have you seen what's going on in this nation, this nation, this nation, this nation, this state, 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 city, 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 and it's like, oh my goodness, like, wow, I'm overwhelmed. Or there's this self-righteous, like, there are all the evil people, being evil, doing evil things. I don't ever put myself in a compromising situation. Praise God, I don't ever even talk to an evil person. But this verse puts it right here. It says, look, this is a serious foe. And it's not just a matter of, you know, cloistering yourself in that. No, we're like, that's not realistic. That's not what God has for us. But this lets us know that evil is hell-bent on your destruction. It desires your downfall. But what it desires for your downfall, God, somebody finish it for me. God intends for your good. Evil is so good because we realize and not, we can't face it, defeat it on our own. I don't care how strong you are, I don't care how powerful you are, I don't care how funny you are, we are not going to defeat evil on our own. Pico Gonzalez says, evil is not just something we do, but it's something that we are bound by. Something from which we must be free. I think about going to Lincoln Park Zoo. We went there recently and it was amazing. I like your hat, by the way. And you're at the zoo, and you know the lions at the zoo? And all the kids are there just like, oh, and it always really bothers me. But imagine that lion praying and saying, Lord, deliver me from evil. And it's meaning like, hey, it's been raining a lot lately, and I just like to make it. It's meaning like, you know what, I'm tired of looking at this today, I would like to get it. And it's praising genuinely, Lord, deliver me from the evil. Not even realizing that you're all caged up. You shouldn't even be in this cage right now. I don't want to pray and just say, Lord, deliver me, Lord, I can't wait for you. When it's like, no, there's evil that's bound us up. Lord, deliver us from that evil. Not just from a cloudy day. And praise God that he can do that. Our very identity as the people of God are being a free people. From the oppressor, from the evil one, from the evil forces in this world. When we see Jesus facing them, resisting temptation, every single moment without sin. By the way, he knows temptation more than anyone. Because when you and I give in to temptation, if you resist temptation to the very end, then you know temptation more than anyone. You don't believe me, believe C.S. Lewis. That's the way to put it. Jesus resisted temptation all the way through. Even when he said, Lord, I don't want to do this, but not my will. Your will be done. And in so doing, he destroyed the powers of evil, set us free from the cage that bound us, and set us forth as free people who can
confidently call out, "We put deliverance from the power of evil." Paul wrote it this way in Ephesians 4. He says, when he ascended on high, he led captivity. He led captivity captive. He took the cage that surrounds the lion, he just took it. Said, "No, you're good to go. Don't worry about food. You can go get it. Sorry, food." How can we be prepared for the test that we will face? Humility. Community. Honesty. And by the power. And only by the power of Jesus Christ. But I want you to be thinking how you will prepare. First and foremost, you got to be praying. This is a prayer. Begin your day acknowledging, "Man, Jesus, you're the one who can deliver me from evil." Prayer. Secondly, I want you to be planning. If you don't have a plan, it's just going to, like, what things are going to happen to you, you're not necessarily going to create change in your life. It's going to be foreseen. In a couple weeks, small groups will be started. Plan. Say, "I got to be there because I got to be in the community that's going to help me." And trust me, as somebody who's been a Christian for a while, here's how small groups happen often in the middle of the week for me. That day off, I'm like, there's like 15 other things I'd rather do today. And I'm tired, and I love canceled plans, and I love being home by myself. And if I don't have a plan and a commitment, it's probably not going to happen. And I think that might be because there's an evil one who doesn't want me to be in that community. So pray and plan. Some of you just need to flee. You need to flee the temptation. You need to flee the test that you're in. Paul says, looking at the nation of Israel, their failings, he said, these took place as an example. He goes on to say, "No temptation has come upon you except for the common of humanity." This isn't unique to you. This is our experience as humanity. But God is faithful. He will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able. But with the temptation, he will also provide the way out so that you may be able to bear it. And then the very next thing he says that might clue us into how does God provide a way out, it says, "So then, my dear friends, flee." Flee. God will provide a way out. Flee. Don't stay there and say God will provide a way out and just stay there. Flee. In closing, I wanna just share a story from Scripture. And it's a story that we know. It's the story of that little brother Joseph, who knew that there was a call of God on his life. And his brothers didn't really like that. They threw him into slavery. So he's ripped out of his family. He's where he's comfortable, where he's experiencing the call of God. And now he's in a foreign land, in slavery, but he's in slavery. He's allowing this test to prove and shape his character. And his master's wife is attracted by this person. And she says, "Hey, look, let's do some things. I know you have some desires." And what does he do? He flees. He flees so quickly that his clothes come off. Scripture's so amazing. I don't know where he fled to, but he flees. And you will say, "Man, what an amazing man of God. I'm sure God rewarded him." Yeah, you bet. He gets thrown into prison. Falsely accused. Thrown into prison. But these tests are shaping his character. They're proving and shaping his character. So he's in prison. And there are some people, some friends, that he's getting to know, and they're influential. And they have some dreams. And Joseph knows how to interpret dreams by the power of God. And he does, and they get promoted. And they're like, "Hey, we'll remember this. Forget all about it." He's nobody. He's just some slave in the prison. They forget all about it. So he's still in prison. He's been faithful time and time and time again. Some of you are like, "I've been faithful for a long time, and God's not coming through. Just wait." So he's faithful. Until it's God's time. Until
You are ready. You're not just ready to deliver yourself out of evil. You're not just ready to deliver your family out of evil. I'm gonna raise you to a position second to the Pharaoh, the most influential person, so you can deliver the whole nation out of famine. We often are just like, Lord, if you can deliver me out of evil, so we're like, your plans for me can be prosperous. God's got bigger plans for you. He's got bigger plans for us. He wants to prove and shape your character so we don't just deliver ourselves out of evil, but we deliver our family. We deliver our community by preaching a gospel that only God can deliver us from evil. Would you stand with me again? Father, we're weak people, God. But we are weak people who are loved by you, and that makes all the difference. We are weak people who are empowered by you, God, and that makes all the difference. And God, we know that the enemy would like nothing more than for us to think that we are strong people on our own. But we acknowledge today that we are weak people empowered and loved by you, whose characters are not being hammered to be broken, but who are being chiseled to the God that you are speaking with to be. So we ask that as we go forth from here, you would empower us by your Holy Spirit. God, to pray, to plan, to flee what we need to flee from, God. That you would use us in a mighty way, God. We pray all